and built into those noble hulls. These were beautiful ships. And they had no power and no need of power because power was itself destructive. Look at that sail. She's rolling, of course. Running before it, you roll. The wind in the side of the sails keeps the ship more or less at a constant angle of heel, but there she's running before these very great seas that rise up, always threatening to break on board from behind her, but they almost never do, and it's just as well. And it's a big Cape Horn ship, a steel vessel carrying 3,000 tons, with a crew of only 30 or less. Fewer people doing more work more effectively. And yet, of course, already, even when this was developed, facing the ruin that came with the powered ship and put them all out of business. But fortunately, when I was a kid and was born down there in Melbourne in Australia in the first decade of this 20th century, and these ships were still doing a hell of a lot of the world's work. They used to come to Australia with, I remember when I was a kid, there was a line of clippers called the Lock Line, and they used to bring general cargo from Glasgow and London out to Melbourne, and there'd sometimes be three or four of them in the dock, and then load wool home for the auctions. And when they had a belly full of wool, they just went outside there, got towed outside the heads, set sail and ran for Cape Horn. They'd be past the Horn a month out from Melbourne, past the line 2 months out, and coming up to the wool auctions in about 3 months, steadily. Well, what's wrong with taking 3 months? A peaceful 3 months, and they used only God's wind, and the sea bashed them too, as you can see here, the sea bashed them, but they were built strong and they could take the bashing. Some were lost, of course, some were lost. That's the way life is, something's always going to be lost. But these vessels used only the understood winds of the ocean. The wind doesn't just blow as it listeth, but it blows according to pattern and known meteorological rules, and the sailing ship master knows these rules and knows where he'll find good winds to take him from Australia to the Horn. It's only 6,000 miles. Get outside Melbourne heads there and let her go. Look at the cutwater there on that big 3,000-ton four-masted bark, clipping along 16 knots, and it doesn't cost a thing. She's using nothing, she's polluting nothing. And the wind is still there after she's passed for the next man to use too. And I must say, I've always thought all the days of my life that it was a silly thing to give all this up. It was brought to perfection and then thrown away. And I notice now that there is so much talk of pollution and God only knows what and the overuse of so many things. People talk about bringing back the use of the wind to drive ships at sea. Well, where do they get the know-how when they have destroyed it? There is no ship like this. There hasn't been a ship like this for at least the last 10 or 15 years, and a powered ship will not take the place of these vessels without engines at all. They needed no engines. We made our passages. I was in these ships as long as I could be and stayed in them. The life was rough, of course.
Could be the North was right and I reached to all concerned, but it isn't. The lights are very
disappears, something's always going to be lost.